Welcome to TheoTrade. This is Don Kaufman. Here we are, October 25th, 2017. Let's get right to it. There's just about 19 minutes left in today's cash market session with quite a lot of volatility. And there's going to be a lot to cover here on this evening's video. So sit down, stay tuned, and hopefully you're still decent amounts of caffeine in you. All right, to begin with, the S&Ps this morning, again, saw a little bit of volatility. We sold off, the S&Ps were down about 25 handles. So time out for just a second on that particular front. Again, we still have lots of time left on the clock today, but the S&Ps ultimately getting down here to 25.41, you got to realize, again, it's a 25-point down move in the S&Ps, which amounts to roughly 1%, which is what? Absolutely nothing. It's not even a 1% move. So I want to reiterate a stance that I took a couple of days ago, both in our chat room and in one of these videos. And the stance is a very easy one. Okay, we've seen so much buy the dip, buy the dip, buy the dip, buy the dip. Everybody's getting used to it. Oh, we can buy this, we can buy this. The only problem today, yeah, you could have bought the dip a couple times over here. That may not have worked out so well. And with the next 18 minutes of trade left, we could see still some sell side activity. Nevertheless, the statement that I want to make that I think is extraordinarily relevant at this point is, well, first and foremost, you better be comfortable with your risk. If today even, I guess, kind of brushed you wrong a little bit, or if you felt the fear at any point today, it wasn't even but a 1% move inside of the S&Ps, okay? And we're facing a record. We've gone the longest period of time here. We're just coming up to this record, the longest period of time without a 3% move in the S&Ps. Now, again, I just want to remind people of this. Is that to scare you? Of course it is. Right? To me, the most important thing is not just getting a feel for the market by watching these videos here each night at TheoTrade or joining us in the chat room throughout the course of the day, some good trades today. The most important thing is to keep you intact, keep you alive, and keep you in the know as a trader. And if, you know, sometimes it got to shake you up a little bit, okay, we will. So again, this is a big nothing event. Hey, you know, I've been, again, a little bit of a bear. Am I happy to see a little bit of down activity? Not really when it's the amount of 1%. You have to start to put into perspective a 3% move. You're looking at 75, 80 S&P points before this becomes quote-unquote serious. Now, to reiterate kind of a comment that I was going to start with, for the markets to really get going to the downside, you know, and again, we keep seeing the buy the dip, buy the dip. For the markets to really crack to the downside, my belief is the only way that effectively happens is with what I kind of call shock and awe. And that ultimately amounts to you waking up one morning into S&Ps that are already in severe trouble. And that's when the sell side activity really kicks in, and we get a day where we're down 3, 4, maybe 5, 6% even so much in the S&Ps. And again, you shouldn't be surprised by the idea right now of even a 100-point move in the S&Ps. And the reason you say you shouldn't be surprised by that, because on a percentage basis, that is very relevant to many of the moves that we've seen. Okay, even in recent history, all right, maybe not over the last year, but even the last 3 to 5 years, you know, a 3% move, it's just people lose perspective because now this is a $2,550 product. Okay, so let's move past that, that clearly we're not at shock and awe over here. And yeah, the volume picked up. Now, let's get to what I believe is really driving some of the trade. What's driving a lot of the trade out there, and I mentioned this in the weekend update, it's about bonds, okay? First of all, there's a lot of nerves facing the possibility that Yellen gets canned, right? So Yellen could get switched out at any moment over here. We're one tweet away from possibly a new Fed chairperson. You just don't know. I think I give the odds at best like 50-50 over here. The administration, it's anything but certain. However, okay, there is one thing that there is a degree of certainty. Whoever comes in to replace, or the possibility of replacing Yellen, is going to be substantially more hawkish than Yellen. What that amounts to is they're likely to want to speed up the pace of raising rates, which amounts to what? Sell side activity in the bonds. Now, again, I mentioned this in the weekend update, and I don't want to rehash it. We hit an absolutely critical threshold of 152. Now, listen, you can go back, pull up a chart for the last 3 years inside of the bonds. In fact, I'll even go back here, go to futures, adjust for contract changes, right there, hit apply, hit okay. And to show you how pivotal some of these levels are, you can start back again years, and we are now cracking below that. So again, that door is open, and could this be it? I mean, there's a lot of big bond kind of gurus out there, and by guru, I mean, you know, people that have a few billion dollars, like Double Line Capital actually came out and said, this could be the big one. You know what that means? That means it can be massive sell side activity inside of the bonds. And at this point, I wouldn't necessarily try to position myself around sell side activity for the bonds because, again, we're one tweet away from the bonds ripping back to the upside if Yellen gets kind of reinstated, right? You know, the stay of execution out there for Yellen, these bonds could rip back up. However, it's the bond trade, okay? The bond selling off is influencing, right, the 10-year rate. Now, the 10-year relates, of course, to the ZM, but this is interest rates. So the interest rates now have exploded all the way back almost to that kind of fateful number of 2.5%. So this is the interest rate, again, associated with the 10-year, and now we're just shy of that 2.5%. So is this helpful to markets? It's extraordinarily helpful to the financials. And let's get down to the financials because this is what's really driving trade. If you look at this chart, okay, on 9/8 was the bottom of the financials, and the financials have done nothing but rip to the upside. What's actually driving the financials? It's good earnings. No, it's not. Nobody cares about the earnings. Come on, Bank of America, right? It's nothing more than the interest rate. Look, there's the bottom right there, right? On September 8th, they ripped to the upside. There's only one problem with this. Interest rates coming higher, okay, at a relatively moderate pace is wonderful for financials. Interest rates exploding higher and vaulting higher over here can be devastating to the financials because they could be trading on the wrong side of the yield curve. Today, the trade starts to invert on the XLF. This, people, is serious. Okay, if the bonds continue to sell off, okay, the financials could get absolutely rocked. You have to realize that right on the cusp of an idea here where you could actually see bonds down big, S&P's down big. Where's the capital go? Ain't nowhere to hide. That's when they're actually going to come running into the volatility products. And guess what? The volatility products, they caught fire in early trade today. Because I'm telling you, I'm not the only one seeing this over here. The VVIX got to a fateful number of 113. Anytime the VVIX gets above 110, put your helmet on, people. I mean, seriously, put your helmet on. And I know some of you technicians are like, oh, I think that's a head and shoulders over there. It doesn't matter. What this ultimately means of the VVIX getting up in this neighborhood over here, it means the professionals, they got their hedge on. Okay, they got their hedge on. And that is a scary premise because it can allow markets to kind of free fall without the professionals taking extraordinary risks. Now, again, I'm recording this with quite a bit of time left in the market because I wanted to show you, hey, the sell side activity, it's alive and well. But I want to reiterate that stance once again over here. This is not shock and awe, 0.6%. Call me when the S&Ps are down, you know, 60, 70 points, and I might give you, you know, a little bit of a smirk because this is not, okay, real sell side activity. But I will tell you, they're warming up to it. And that's something you have to realize. We have so many different marketplaces right now hitting inflection points. You just saw volatility, okay, and the VVIX spiking to 110. You got the bonds at a critical inflection point over here. You got the XLF that now is not what? It's not trading, all right, with those bonds. I mean, the bonds are selling off. That should help the XLF. But no, that relationship all of a sudden snaps and kind of inverts. And now the XLF starts selling back off. It's down right in line pretty much with the S&Ps. So a tremendous amount going on inside of today's trade. Now I'm going to throw one more caveat at you with a few minutes, and I'm going to cover this in a bit more depth tomorrow in TheoTrade. So write the TheoTrade chat room, join us first thing in the morning. Something I'm picking up here in Google, very, very odd trade is going on inside of the options here. I just froze the screen for just a moment. In the options market, in terms of implied volatility, right? Implied volatility, what is it? Okay, well, it's for the most part, it's the supply and demand effect. It's, okay, what a bid and offer come together. The bid and offer, all right, obviously make the options market. So if you take a look at an options market and you're looking at a bid and an offer out here, and these options just ultimately have 2 days, and I'll unfreeze it here, a lot of lines going on the screen. But if you take a look at any bid and offer, the implied volatility can kind of be derived from the bid ask. These implied volatilities that we're looking at are actually the mid price between the bid and the offer. So you can see the puts out here are trading at about 53 and change. You go out to the calls and they're even higher. That is actually an inverted implied volatility skew. What that ultimately amounts to is the risk now is to the upside. It wasn't like that a day or two ago. Okay. The other thing that we're seeing in here, by the way, you can look back at previous earnings announcements, you will not see an inverted implied volatility skew. I also picked up on this inside of Amazon. Now, if you take a look at the charts, you can look at them all you want. You're not going to see much activity, all right, as we approach the earnings. The earnings are Thursday after the bell. But Amazon, looking at its option chain, is similar in respect, but Google is definitely inverted. If you take a look at Amazon, the at-the-money options about 55%. Some of these out-of-the-money calls are closer to like 53, 54%. But look at that. They're trading, okay? The calls are trading for a value over the puts. I'm going to show tomorrow within the chat room here, kind of live on TheoTrade, what that really amounts to, okay, specifically, and effectively how we can take advantage of it. Again, an inverted implied volatility skew coming into some major earnings announcements really does speak volumes about this marketplace. So with that, the S&Ps, okay, what did they do? They're hanging in there today. Again, we're going to be down about 0.5% at the close. The Nasdaq faring rather well. Everything for the most part is in alignment. With that, again, join us here at TheoTrade chat all throughout the course of the day. Thanks, everybody. Have a wonderful evening. Bye-bye.